will swear in its first black governor later this week in Annapolis. Kalafasane introduces us to Wes Moore, an already accomplished public servant with quite an agenda.
Politics is a very humbling business. When we first got into this race, I was polling at 1%.
He's a best-selling author, an army captain, and now a first-times-the-charm politician. Maryland's Democratic governor-elect Wes Moore won in a landslide.
Thank you, Maryland!
Beating his Republican opponent with more than twice as many votes.
We ended up receiving 89% of the vote in Baltimore.
A vote of confidence from a city that's struggling. High crime rates, high poverty rates, high unemployment rates.
A lot of smart people have been working on these issues for a long time. Yeah. What makes you think you can do something that all these smart, talented people haven't been able to do?
I think we have to approach this that it's not about what program can we institute. Right? It's about how are we changing the entire human condition that people are existing in.
Changing the entire human condition.
That's exactly right. Because, you know, you could have a person.
That's a tall order for a governor.
It's a very tall order, but it's doable. We've got to change the entire ecosystem. It's the air people breathe. It's the water that they drink. It's the homes that they are living in. It's transportation assets they have or don't have. It's the way they are policed. And that's something that a governor can actually fix.
For instance, in Maryland, as in most other states, even if someone doesn't personally kill anyone, if they're involved in a felony that leads to murder, they can be charged with so-called felony murder. Wes Moore told us he supports a bill that would prohibit that charge for juveniles.
When you're looking at the juvenile justice system, we can't forget these are children that we're talking about.
So are you open to signing that bill?
Yeah, I'm absolutely open to looking at how can we come up with ways of being able to make sure that our society is accountable, yet at the same time, never forgetting we're still talking about children in all of this.
You sound like you could do this in your sleep. If I busted into your bedroom at 3 a.m, you could give a stump speech.
Well, I love this work. I'd never run for public office before, but I've been a public servant for my entire life.
He seems like someone who gets a vision and then pursues it. How stubborn is he?
I wouldn't say stubborn. He's a wonderful partner. He's hard charging. He's mission driven.
Dawn Flythe Moore and her husband have been married for 15 years.
So, I need on tape that she said I'm not stubborn.
I was going to say, I think I might use that at home. I tell my wife, no. I'm hard charging.
I'm hard charging.
I'm mission driven.
It's true.
Since 2016, Wes and Dawn Moore have lived in Baltimore. This week, the family is moving to the governor's mansion in Maryland's capital.
You've got two kids who grew up here in Baltimore.
Yes.
How did you sell them on Annapolis?
Well, the puppy. We will be getting a puppy.
One of your own is going to be running the state government.
We're so excited about it.
Bishop Dante Hickman leads Southern Baptist Church in East Baltimore, where Wes Moore is a member.
Do you remember when he told you, Bishop, I'm thinking of maybe running for governor?
It was almost like we had to push him. We really felt like he had the moral compass and clarity, and that he could build consensus around the state.
And he has a resume seemingly built for this moment. He's a Johns Hopkins graduate, a Rhodes Scholar, and a soldier who fought in Afghanistan. He worked as an investment banker and ran Robin Hood, a nonprofit organization.
There was never a time when I said, this is gonna be great when I run for governor one day. But every single one of those experiences prepared me for this.
Wesley Watende Omari Moore, 44, was born in Tacoma Park, Maryland, a suburb of Washington. His father died in 1982 when Moore was 3.
This is my grandfather, Reverend James Joshua Thomas. This picture was actually taken right around the time that my dad died.
When Moore was 5, his mother took him and his 2 sisters to live with her parents in the Bronx in New York City.
Their house was barely big enough for them. But when my mom called and said she needed help, they figured out a way to make it big enough for all of us.
By 1989, Moore was acting out.
I am a kid who was 11 years old with handcuffs on my wrists.
I think you might be the first governor who has ever previously been arrested for graffiti.
That's probably right. And I think about how different that could have turned out, right? Because in my case, I'm sitting there in the back of a police car with my friend, and then eventually after, a talk and a lecture, The officer pulls me out of the car, unlocks the cuffs, and lets me go.
It's a story he told in his best-selling 2011 memoir, The Other Wes Moore. But these days, it comes with a moral.
I want us to be a society that believes in second chances. I want the people who are receiving the second chances also understand that, you know, at some point, second chances become last chances.
Right.
And I want people to understand their own individual power of being able to change the lives of people.
Moore's own transformation began when his family sent him to military school in Pennsylvania. He was 13. A year later, his mom moved back to a suburb outside of Baltimore for a steady job with benefits at a nonprofit.
That job didn't just change her life, it changed the trajectory for our entire family. And so it was from that point that when people said, "Where are you from?" my answer was easy: Baltimore.
Many found that answer misleading. During the campaign, Moore was criticized for exaggerating his connection to Baltimore, but he hasn't wavered.
I'm not a Baltimorean by birth. I'm a Baltimorean by choice. I believe in this place. I believe in this city. I believe in the people here.
There's a lot of work to do, right?
Yes. Yes, there is.
And now, as he gets ready for life as governor in Annapolis, he is confident that they believe in him.
What do people in this congregation, what do they ask you to do there?
Don't forget them. The thing that they oftentimes say most to me is, just don't forget us.